Thank you. Thank you very much. I am very, very excited about this session. We're going to be joined by two people who've been working together for 45 years. They are the longest running headline act in Las Vegas. Their show on skepticism ran for 8 seasons. They have invented magic which has changed the face of the entire conjuring industry. Iconic pieces that we're going to explore. Please give a huge psychon welcome to the legendary Penn and Teller.
Forty-eight years.
They've been together for an amazing 48 years. 48, wow, my goodness. First of all, welcome. Thank you very much for finding the time. I know you're enormously busy. What I thought we would do is start off by talking about your beginnings, if that's okay. And if we could cut to the slides, because I have a few little images to show folks. So hopefully we'll see a Penn and Teller up there. And we're going to see it here. Yes, yes. There we are. That's wonderful. That's good. There's one person actually applauded just the slides appearing there, which is nice. There we go. Perfect. So let me start off by showing you an image, getting one of you to talk to it. And this is the picture. It is a very...
Which one is that? One of us.
It's a very young Teller. I'm not certain how old you would be there, Teller. Maybe 7 or 8 or something like that. You have a top hat on and...
The more typical thing is I do have a black art table there, so I would have been into magic several years by then. So I'm guessing, yeah, 8.
8, okay. And I wonder if you could tell us, the next image, as I know, is key to your beginnings, and it's a very particular magic set. I wonder if you could tell us how you got into magic and how that magic set influenced you.
I got very sick when I was a kid. I had toxic myocarditis, which is next door to rheumatic fever. They took me to a hospital I have a horrifying memory of being in the hospital the night that they did a transfusion on me and saved my life. But eventually I came home and I was stuck at home for a long time, drinking tea and eating toast and watching TV. And the television show that I liked the best was Howdy Doody. Howdy Doody had a magic clown named Clarabelle. And Clarabelle advertised a Howdy Doody magic set for 3 Mars bars wrappers and 75 cents. And we put it in an envelope, sent it away, and it came back. And it looked very much like the tan envelope in that picture. And of course, I was expecting a magic set, you know, with things in it. But instead, it was a magic set with cardboard in it. And I took the pieces of cardboard out, and with the assistance of my parents, this was at the age of 5, tabbed them together and began to play with them the way a kid plays with magic, which a kid doesn't think much about performing for other people. A kid thinks about what it would be like to perform it for himself. And that's what I did. And looking at that, for the first time, I think, I got the notion in my head that things could look one way and be another way. And that was tremendously fascinating to me. And that led to all of the usual children's activities, child magician activities. You know, you try to do tricks for your friends and you fail. Mm-hmm. You do tricks for your grandmother and your grandmother grabs the props out of your hand because she's very curious and mean. And then eventually you acquire a lot of equipment, which you think is where the magic resides. And you do shows, and in my case, I always did shows with Asian themes. I at times impersonated what was a fashionable image of a Chinese man at the time. At other times, I wore a turban, which is probably not so fashionable nowadays either. And I did shows in my backyard for a limited number of kids. Formed the Philadelphia Junior Puppeteers, which did both magic and puppetry. We did one show called St. George and the Dragon. And this continued until I got, I mean, I could take the other 70 years that intervene and go through them year by year if you'd like, but you probably don't want that.
So with Clarabelle, was it Clarabelle the clown?
Yes.
Now, because Clarabelle didn't speak.
Yeah, it's really weird that I didn't realize until just a few years ago that the figure that got me into magic was a non-speaking magical clown.
And do you trace it back to that, the idea of...
I don't know. I didn't work silent until, I want to say, my college days, I guess.
Okay.
And I worked silent because I found that for me, it was a good way to discipline, insofar as I was capable of doing that, a rowdy audience.
Okay.
Because if you walk out to a rowdy audience and you say nothing, they find it hard to exactly know how to heckle you. And if you know what you're doing, if you know where you're going with a particular routine, if you have a very clear picture of where you're going, the audience realizes that. They sense that you're taking them someplace, and eventually they start to focus in on it.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Penn, your picture is you in a giant pumpkin suit. Would you like to speak to that picture in the context? I mean, it's Halloween, so it seems appropriate. In the context of the set that influenced you, which I believe to be Kreskin's ESP games or whatever it was.
Yeah. Teller was motivated, he was kind of attracted by all this stuff that I did not like at all. I hated being in that pumpkin suit.
No.
I dislike Halloween.
How did you end up in the pumpkin suit?
What's that?
How did you end up in the pumpkin suit?
I imagine, you know, I was very close to my mom and dad, and they probably thought it would be fun for me to be in the pumpkin suit. And I probably, you know, that's one picture, because that was back before we had 10,000 pictures of everything. And so I probably did have some fun in it, but my memory of it, which may have been triggered by that picture, we know that all that shit happens. That I probably don't have any real memories of it, but my memory was never enjoying Halloween at all. It just, I mean, now that it's, you know, sexy goes before everything, you know, sexy nurse, sexy pilot, I found a way to like Halloween more.
Right.
But I don't think there's, well, there may be a few people who would label that sexy pumpkin, but I'm not one of them.
No. We could put that to the vote, but I don't think...
And I've told the story of my relationship with magic a zillion times to audiences just like this, so I'll try to truncate as much as possible. I never liked magic at all. To me, the magicians were the ones who got in the way of me seeing rock and roll on variety shows. You know, the person that followed the Beatles, their first appearance on Ed Sullivan was a magician, which is the funniest thing in the world. Who gives a fuck? And, you know, the world is changing and magicians go on, you know, using a thumb tip. And I became a juggler, which is, we all know, a lower ring of show business than magic, but above puppets. And I got to be fairly good at juggling, and I also spent a lot of time at the library. Okay. And I saw Kreskin on one of the shows. It could not, I remember it as being Johnny Carson, but it couldn't have been because Johnny Carson did not allow him on, one.
Oh,
and
okay.
Two, it was not, I probably would have been up that late. So it must have been some sort of Merv Griffin or Mike Douglas thing. And he did a scientific experiment. And the scientific experiment had to do with ESP. And I was very taken with that. I was very, very much into science. And I begged my parents to buy me the science kit, which was the Kreskin ESP kit. And my sister already left. She was much older than me, 23 years older than me. So she'd already moved out from the time I was an infant. And so I was essentially raised as an only child. And so when I got the ESP kit, the only person I could do this with was my mom and dad, pretty much. And we did all the experiments. I did all the bookkeeping and everything and kept track of everything. And then the Greenfield Public Library, the juggling books are right near the magic books. And I guess it's fortunately they're not near the Nazi books. Maybe it's a wash, I don't know. I happened to, and I'm sure that none of this can be true, because the way we tell stories to ourselves, but the way I remember the story, honestly, that doesn't mean it's accurate, was that I found the book on mentalism, the Dunninger book, and it had the trick in it that Kreskin had done, okay, which I don't believe can be true, but something close enough that I realized that I'd been hornswoggled. And I reacted in a way that very, very inappropriate. I went from an A student in science to flunking.
Really?
I went from overall, because I thought scientists lied to us.
Hold on a second. So Kreskin is either claiming to be psychic or ambiguous about what he's
doing.
He
was never ambiguous. He claimed to be psychic.
Okay. And then you discover that maybe that isn't the complete truth.
I discovered that that was a complete lie, and my reaction to it was inappropriate. I essentially stopped all studying at school, and I hated magicians. Magicians and scientists had ganged up in order to embarrass me in front of my parents and steal money from my parents. And I was very angry about that. And I remained hating magic, which I'd never liked. It wasn't like it turned around, but I went to really, absolutely despising it until I not met, but read James Randi, then met him shortly after that, and then met Teller shortly after that. Because remember, I was 17 when I met Teller.
Okay.
So the time between the Kreskin set, where I was probably 14 or 15, was a very short period of time. But I had managed to go from a straight A student to flunking, and then met Teller, and Teller told me that magic could be done honestly, and it could be done with respect, and it could be intellectual,
okay,
and that that changed my life.
Excellent. So, okay, amazing, amazing. We go to 1975.
What's that?
1975.
Sure.
And there's the. Do you want to quickly tell us who's in this picture?
Well, I'm the one laying on the xylophone.
Yes.
No, that's Weir Kissimer, who's the one who got us together. And it's Teller with the hat, and that's me with the leather jacket. And that's a thing called the Asparagus Valley Cultural Society.
Okay.
And that was the first time, not actually, the first time we worked together was just the two of us. But very shortly after that, we did a show with a lot failures, mostly failures, but we ended up by 1979 in San Francisco doing a show, and it was as successful as we could be for that level. We had 153-seat theater; it was filled all the time, and we ran for 965 shows, which put us as the longest-running show at that time at that level in San Francisco, and I think the way I've decided to remember it. Although it's certainly more complicated than this, was that we were doing a show that most of which I'd written when I was 20, and I was now 26, 27, and Teller and I were just overflowing with new ideas we wanted to do that were to fail, just to make that clear. And Weir Kissimer wanted to just keep doing that show and go to Off-Broadway and keep doing it forever. And Teller and I liked working more than we liked doing anything else. And Weir liked doing anything else more than he liked working. And I don't mean any disrespect from that. He was able to enjoy life in a way that I've never been very good at. And I've always liked working with Teller. So there's a couple ways to look at this. The way we always chose to look at this was that the whole group split up, and then Teller and I started working together.
And if we were to go back in time and say to the two of you at that point, you're going to go on to headline in Vegas and be the most iconic magicians of your generation, would you have believed it at that point? Was that something you wanted to happen?
Nothing I ever wanted. I never wanted to be a Vegas magician. I never wanted to be on Broadway. All I've ever wanted is to be Bob Dylan, and I failed. But
how about you, Teller?
Walk softly and carry a big light bulb.
How about you, Teller? If back at that time, did you want to be a big star?
No, I wanted not to be a school teacher. I had been a school teacher for 6 years, and the idea of being able to earn my living doing absolutely what I purely love, especially in the San Francisco run, where we were really very comfortable, 153 people is a lot of people. That's an exhilarating thing to do. I was totally happy and did not expect. I was saying to myself, this is fine. I'd be happy to do this for the rest of my life. And I would have.
That's what we intended to do, both of us.
Yeah.
I mean, I want to say everything Teller's saying, I agree with. We are some of the only people in show business. I mean, Paul McCartney has said on record that he thinks the Beatles should have been more successful than they were. He said that many times. It's astonishing. Teller and I may be the only two people in show business that really are more successful than we deserve, intended, or wanted. We were very happy to be 100, you know, we were just off by a more order of magnitude in our dreams. We were very happy. We were happy to play cruise ships. That was what we were working for. We played fairs. And at the time I teamed up with Teller, I was homeless. So anything was going to be a step up.
And in terms of, I mean, when people become famous, that brings all sorts of pressures and so on with it. In terms of happiness, were you happier then? Are you happier now?
There's been a lot of studies on this, and I don't think that success has any impact on that whatsoever. Once you get, I mean, you have to always say, once you get your basic needs dealt with. I mean, there's an actual dollar figure, but I've forgotten it. But beyond that, success and money yield nothing.
I prefer working at theaters that are indoors to working at the Minnesota Renaissance Festival among the mosquitoes.
Okay, if we move on to something I couldn't find out very much about this, actually, but it's your seance and horror.
That was not our first huge failure, but it was one of them.
Was this not a success?
Oh, it was a disaster. It was the first thing that we did after the wonderfully successful Asparagus Valley Cultural Society show, where we were going off saying, we can do something even better than that. And we made every conceivable mistake. We cast the wrong person to play the principal character. We cast me in a speaking role. Terrible idea. We cast Penn in a directing role. Terrible idea.
The worst director that's ever lived.
And on top of it all, it was a bad idea not done at the correct time in the culture of the United States of America.
And then done badly, not at the right time.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
And we put all our money into it. We went from being, to my mind, and even in our, you know, we're both middle class, where we were brought up. My father was a jail guard, Telly's father, commercial artist. And we were making unbelievable money. I mean, Jesus Christ, I was like 26 years old, and we were doing 8 shows a week, and I had absolutely no expenses, and I didn't do drugs. I mean, I was just fucking rolling in cash. And so we took all that money and put it into a show and lost it all.
Yeah, we did. I think Penn was the one who said, how much can we afford to lose? And we said, $10,000. We can afford to lose $10,000. And we did.
I remember as being more than that, but whatever it was, that's true.
So
we lost all our money.
I don't want to dwell on the failure too long, but what form...
Oh, linger on it. Go ahead.
It doesn't hurt us that much. You want to linger on the newer failures to break our heart.
But what... So I would have thought a horror seance would be a shoo-in, but people just didn't want to come.
Well, maybe it would be, but we sucked at it. We were trying to be very, very heavy, and we were also talking about things we knew nothing about. We knew nothing about grief. We knew nothing about suffering. And we were talking about that. And we also really, we were entertainers and not playwrights. And we were trying to incorporate magic tricks into theater, which is a very difficult thing to do. And I mean, every single detail we can talk about, we can tell you where we made mistakes. I don't believe it's particularly interesting. No. And also the information's wrong because we don't remember it correctly. We can't even agree on how much fucking money we lost.
But before that, at least around this time, you had the formula of Teller not talking and you talking.
Oh yeah, that went back to the very first thing we did together.
I find that amazing. So even from that...
And that is one of the things we violated in this.
Right. You know, okay.
Bad idea.
I find it amazing you found that successful formula so early on.
We didn't find it. We didn't create it. I mean, Teller was not talking. Teller is 100% responsible for everything. I had no input. I had no input into going into magic. I had no knowledge of magic. And I had no input whatsoever in the characters we created. I was just a dumb juggler who, you know, got lucky. But I didn't, it's not, you know, Tommy Smothers was talking to us about how brilliant it was that Teller didn't speak and I did speak so that the audience could project upon Teller what
yes.
they were thinking. And this is a problem with all two-person teams, that you don't have a person for the audience to project upon. You have to kind of both take that roles. And Tommy said all this really, really smart stuff about what we had done that I deserved no credit for. And Teller deserved some credit, but not as much as Tommy was giving him.
I don't deserve any credit at all. I was just trying to keep those frat boys from attacking me by being very silent, and that I got into the habit. So I just persisted in the habit.
And I was trying to make enough money to eat as a juggler, so I got very aggressive verbally.
Okay.
And I could be again if you want to push me.
Well. It worked out very well. You're on Broadway. This is your, struggle to see out there, but that's what you were doing on Broadway. And one of the interesting things of 1987 is that I think the penultimate item is actually Shadows. I hadn't realized just how far back Shadows
Before
goes.
That.
Even further back than that. And is it still in the show?
It's in some shows. I mean, we have a very large repertoire.
Yes.
I believe we now have probably the largest repertoire of any people who did magic in the history of magic. Because, we were doing the show for the CW, the Penn and Teller Fool Us, that requires a brand new piece of magic at the end of each episode. So, like, for this last episode, we had to have 20. You know, so we have a lot. But Shadows has been there for a long time. It was an old idea of mine from adolescence, inspired by something that I read in a book. But, I thought, we could do it this way and this way and this way. And for the first time, I did it in Asparagus Valley.
Yes.
And in Asparagus Valley, it persisted. It's nice because it's very concise. It's 2 minutes that contains roses, shadows, daggers, and blood. How much gothic information can you get into 2 minutes,
Well, I thought it'd be good, or an interesting way of doing things, to give you a little quiz about your early days. So I've got three questions. This is about your 1987 Broadway show. And the question is, how long was the interval? Was it 10 minutes, 15 minutes, or 20 minutes?
Well, it was announced as 10 and probably ended up 20.
Which might be the correct answer. In the program, it was on at 10 minutes, announced at 10 minutes. That seems really short to me. Was that like a Broadway thing, or was that a Penn and Teller?
I don't know.
I have no recollection. In both off-Broadway and Broadway, you were still going out to talk to the people.
I was always out during an admission talk.
In the lobby, so okay. It's got to go at least 20 minutes if he's doing that.
We have number two here. 1998, in City Spectacular, did Teller walk through a wall, a dragon, a dragon, or a cow?
Teller walked through a goddamn cow.
Very good.
And that was the actual lyrics. This ain't no bris, so don't drop trowel. Teller's gonna walk through a goddamn cow. We had Doug Kershaw, and for those of you who know the history of rock and roll, or even the history of country music, and especially Cajun music, Doug Kershaw is very important. Whether you're talking about Hee Haw, whether you're talking about Neil Young's most important stuff around Harvest and On the Beach, Doug Kershaw was there. And we had Doug Kershaw as our guest, and we really wanted him to play Cajun fiddle. So we had a hootenanny, and we thought a good magic trick was to be for Teller to walk through a cow. So I got to sing with Doug Kershaw. I got to dance, and Teller got to walk through a goddamn cow. And it was a really good trick.
It's really good.
We've tried really hard to find a way to do that live, because I've always thought cows are really funny.
Yes.
And we're using an elephant in the show now, but it's kind of cow-like. And I've always thought it was hysterical that magicians use, you know, tigers and lions and elephants, and that's so grandiose. And I always thought it would be so funny if we could do better tricks, but with a cow, because that's so humble and pedestrian, and also the audience is aware that it is more difficult than the other animals. And to me, that sums up a lot of our sensibility.
I thought so. The good news is I have got a 30-second clip of Teller walking through a cow. Here we are. So this has got sound on it, so I don't think we can bring the lights down very slightly. So this is just 30 seconds of the routine, but it's an amazing piece. So here we go. Fingers crossed with the sound. Great.
God damn, that's a good
That's
trick.
Good.
That's good.
That's really good.
Doug Kershaw on fiddle. That's a really good trick. I wish we could find a way to do that live, but
it's great.
It's hard.
Okay, it looks hard.
And I also should say this, many questions you could ask us, you get the same answer. I don't remember how it's done, and I don't know how it's done. I may not have known at the time, because I'm trying to keep the band together.
Teller, do you have any memories of walking through the cow?
Yes.
Without getting into details, was it quite hard to walk through the cow?
The hardest thing was keeping the cow still.
Because I noticed when the cow...
You're walking through a cow, you just don't want it moving.
It's great. I love that. Okay, moving on. And your first appearance on Letterman, you did a trick where a card is chosen and then Teller stabs you through the hand, the card's impaled on the hand. What was the card David Letterman chose? And we're only going back 30-something years now. So three of clubs, eight of hearts, or four of spades?
I think it was the four of spades.
I would guess it's the four of spades, because the kind of guys we are, we would think when the knife goes through the center of the card, you want all of the pips to be visible to the camera.
Okay.
Even with blood coming down. That's what I would guess.
Okay. Well, the good news is I have a little clip here, and we can find out. Four of spades. Easier or harder than walking through a cow?
Different kind of challenge.
Did it kick off any memories? Was that this your first Letterman appearance?
It was. And it was, I remember most of the Letterman appearance is that I would not do TV until I was 30, so I just turned 30 there, and.
Hold on a second. You said to yourself you wouldn't do.
I didn't want to. I did local TV and stuff, but I was really very, very hesitant, because in San Francisco we'd seen people not helped by television, like Robin Williams and some other friends that I had. So I was kind of avoiding it. It sounds much more thought out than it really was, but I had turned down a couple things. We were the Asparagus Valley. I didn't want to do on national television, and then I got to be about 30. I believe it was like the week of my birthday, but that may not be true. And I was really, really terrified. And I've read since then some studies of people in extreme panic situations, that time slows down, and you go to tunnel vision, and things go to black and white. And when I was on Letterman, and I was out there with Dave, and I was very, very, we ended up doing Letterman as much as anyone has done it, I think, the original show, and not the morning show, but the other show. And I remember being totally mystified as to why Letterman was talking so slowly. It felt like he had all of a sudden started talking like this.
Amazing.
And it's humiliating that going on Letterman could bring that kind of fear to me, because that fear is biologically when your life's in jeopardy and this is a bullshit TV show. But to me, it felt that way. And I remember it being slowed down. And I remember realizing during the commercial, just how crazy Letterman was. And a story I don't really want to tell, but probably should, but I won't. I remember that being my first understanding, even though we were doing Broadway and so on, from my point of view, it was the first time I felt, we could really be with professionals. You know, because David Letterman was, well, still the best at that's ever lived. And the fact that we were sharing a stage with him was really remarkable to me. We did Saturday Night Live, David Letterman, and I was on Howard Stern, all in a very short period of time. Now, this is not the same as Paul McCartney meeting the Pope, Muhammad Ali, and the Queen in 1 week, but for me it was.
Okay. The next one, there's no reason on earth you will know the answer to this. I don't think you will. It's 1994, you're in the UK, it's the unpleasant world of Penn and Teller, and you ask someone in the audience to choose a card, and this is the clip.
How about you, sir, in the white shirt with the brown jacket, okay? Just give me a yo when I should start.
Yo.
Okay?
The question is, I've blocked it out there, who's sitting behind that man?
English, right?
Correct.
Okay. Eric Clapton.
Close. It's me.
I figured.
I don't know if you remember me sitting there, but I'm guessing not.
Yes, it was a life-changing experience.
moving on. So you come to Vegas, and how long did you intend to stay in Vegas? I mean, did you think this was going to be the longest ever headlining act? Or?
We moved to Vegas because Teller was the one who got the idea to get out of New York because it was too cold. And we saw our parents living in cold areas as they were getting very elderly. And Teller said he wanted to grow old someplace that was warmer, which you've been successfully done. And our idea was that would be a hub, and we would do a, maybe a maybe 5 weeks in Vegas every year, and then toured the way we had been touring, and it would be cheaper and more efficient than it had been doing that out of New York, which is what we were really doing, living in New York and then touring most of the year, which was really not financially reasonable. And so we moved out here, and we started playing the MGM, and that was going very well. We really loved that. And then David Copperfield got us fired, and we intended to go into the Rio. And at first, it was just a few months a year, and once it became a steady place. What's best about the Rio, of course, the Rio's now updated. They took pictures of the old guys off the side of the building. But what's best about it is we get to do what we like to do most, which is write new stuff. And I can really say, as much as we've been part of the Vegas community and like living here and have assimilated into it, that as long as we were doing shows, it wouldn't matter where we were.
Okay.
We have an extraordinary place. At the Rio, we have a theater that basically nobody gives a fuck about us. And that is, the hotel doesn't care, the crew doesn't care. So we just do whatever we want there. No one tells us what to put in our show. We never have allowed that, of course. Even our contracts on Broadway, Penn and Teller will decide what's going to be in the show. But when we have an idea, we say to the crew, let's meet at the theater on Friday at 1:30, and we go in and we work. And there's no control other than us, and that is the most liberating sort of thing. Very different from Broadway. You know, if you're on Broadway and you want to make a change in your show, good luck. You know, you have a union crew charging you, you know, $10,000 an hour for you to just walk across the stage. This is very liberating artistically.
But even if you have infinite money, crew calls and all of that are very complex bureaucracy. So when we were on Broadway, even last time, we could not walk on stage and put a deck of cards on a table without that being paperwork. And I mean, I know that there's all sorts of reasons, you know, that there's union rules, but here I believe we pay people very well. We pay them better than union, and everything is ours. So we actually do something that I believe no one else gets to do, including Taylor Swift. And that is, we get to sit on the stage we're going to perform in a couple of chairs and talk about the bits we're going to do. And everybody else rehearses in places that are taped off. You know, when we went to see, we were supposed to be in the Monty Python show that came back, that was playing the O2, you know?
Yeah.
And even, or Prince's rehearsal space, or where the Stones rehearse. The Stones rehearse in a big place that has their whole stadium set up, but is really small. You know, it's tall and very narrow. And I don't think there's anybody, you know, except for the very lower rings of show business, but there's nobody above us that's able to do the creation, some of the building, the rehearsal right on the very stage they're going to, and do it on the timetable that is almost exclusively the two of us. And the people at the Rio don't even know when we change stuff. They don't care. They got slot machines they're worried about. And it turns out that indifference is, other people's indifference towards you is better than power. It really is.
And yours is a very intelligent show. And when you first moved to Vegas, was there some skepticism about whether there'd be an audience for that?
Nothing but. When we first played the Celebrity Room at Bally's, it was everybody thought it was going to be a complete failure. Joel Fishman, our dear friend who died a couple years ago, he was responsible for Atlantic City and responsible for Vegas with us, and nobody thought we were going to sell at all. And we have in the Celebrity Room, which is where Sinatra played and Dean Martin and Liza Minnelli and Willie Nelson and George Carlin, you can go on forever, people that played there, we have the record for the most tickets sold. And wait till I finish. It's a cheat, it's a complete cheat, because when we when we came in, we were the only act who had ever played there that had no friends, no comps, and no high rollers that wanted to see it. So we sold it out with every single ticket. Had we had one friend, but you know, Sinatra or Dean Martin, they would have high rollers, like 50 people. They would have friends, like 20 people. We had absolutely no one come to see us other than the people that paid for tickets.
Penn mentioned Joel Fishman. Joel Fishman started, met us when he was working in Atlantic City, and came to our show off Broadway and said, "You guys could play Atlantic City." And we went, "Oh, those Philistines?" And he said, no, if I pair you up with the right sophisticated jazz acts, that sort of thing, I think I can build you an audience. And he built us an audience. And it developed, and we learned to be able to play that shape of room, that kind of room. Then he was booked out at the Celebrity Room at Bally's and brought us out and just kept giving us artistic support. I mean, huge amounts of artistic support. We had a bit in the show in which we were doing a trick with giant metal playing cards and manipulating them on two forklifts. If we had brought those forklifts out onto that sprung wooden stage, the forklifts would have gone right through. What did Joel Fishman say? Joel Fishman said, "I'll put down metal plates on the stage, weld them in place, and you can do that bit." That level of artistic support was absolutely critical, I think, to our entrance to Vegas.
It took hours to put down the metal plates every time we played there, and it also ended up fucking up our feet and back, but that's not important.
And over all those years, how has Penn and Teller changed?
I don't think you can see that from inside, really, or at least I can. I don't know.
Okay. When we first worked together, I think we fought more in a very, I don't mean rude way, but a more determined way. I think we've learned over the years more to recognize the fact that we're going to have different perspectives on things, and when we come to them, we will come to them from contrary perspectives, and we will work through them. But it's a little calmer to me. It seems a little more loving.
Also, that's a subset. It certainly is more loving and more gentle and more kind. But the other thing is, and we're just better at it. We're just better at everything. And that's something that, in a culture that is so obsessed with youth, that's something that's forgotten. I mean, for all people talk about blonde on blonde, Bob Dylan's latest album is better, and Bob Dylan is 81. And it's because the things that Bob Dylan does are very different than the things that Tom Cruise does. And the things that Bob Dylan does, you actually can learn. I mean, there was that year and a half period of the three albums, you know, Blonde on Blonde, Highway 61, and Bringing It Back Home, where Bob was just so inspired, and the youth was there, and he turned out more material than many people have in that amount of time, Shakespeare, Picasso, others like that. But and that is inspired work, but the work he's doing now is actually better. I think that's true for a lot of people. And because Teller and I are both pluggers, we plug along. We just plug along. For us, being older is nothing but better for our show. And we always have been, I think, not for this reason, but brave for the wrong reasons, probably because of stupidity. But now we're getting to the point that we really don't give a fuck. And that is much better for art. We'll go out and do stuff that we wouldn't have dared do even 15 years ago, that now we do with impunity, because fuck you.
And the other thing that we can't overlook is the fact that some of the people that work with us, our crew, Glenn Ally, our manager, the people that we've worked with, for like 20 years, and they now are part of us. It is one organism. You know, we are at the head of it, pushing it along. But you know, really, we can say to our crew, I don't want to say this because this is going to give away a trick. Just yesterday, we had been talking about some. We had been talking a week ago about something that seemed unlikely, and we came in yesterday with the same idea, and the crew came in and had solved it. They had just solved it for us. They went, "What?" And we went, "That can't possibly work," but it does.
Yeah, and having access to the stage and having a crew that is part of us. And you know, other magicians go through crew members like in 6 months. Our new crew guy is 15 years, I think. That's the new guy. We still treat him like the new guy. And, we've got people that go back. I mean, there's me and, you know, the two of us included, there are probably half the people that work for us have spent more than half their lives working with us. And that's just huge.
And we also, we absolutely, this is not just lip service, we actually do listen to their ideas. You know, I mean, when we're on stage thinking about something, if they get an idea, they are not hesitant to say, what about that? Whether that's their job, it might be the lighting guy, you know, who has that kind of idea. And so there is this real communal sort of feel.
Yeah, they really know what we're trying to do. And also, also money makes a difference in being able. We spend more money on what you could call R&D. Mm-hmm. We go 100 miles an hour down a dead end street and just waste that money, mm-hmm. and it makes the show better.
And it also means that we can get ideas that are bad, try them out and say, that was bad, and throw that away. You know, which is a great skill that took us quite a long while to acquire.
Many people think if you put in time and money, you have to get something out of that. And that's just not true.
And I've seen you work many times, and every time it feels like it's the first time you're doing it. You have that real sense of spontaneity. And I'm always interested in this, performers that have to do the same thing night on night, how do you get that feeling of, for that audience, is the first time?
Often this question, you stated it better, but often people ask this question with the idea that we get bored with material. I believe that we could go out and do that program you popped up there. I believe we could do all, looking over what I could see, that's all material I'd like to do. We do not put in new stuff because we get sick of the old stuff. We put in new stuff because we want to do the new stuff. So we have a really nice balance in our show. When you come to our show in the evening, it's very rare that you can see a show that doesn't have something in it that is more than 30 years old and something in it that is less than a year old.
Okay.
And that combination is really nice, but I guess I should try to take credit for this, but I can't. When I'm on stage doing a bit, it feels like the most important thing in the world to me.
Okay.
No matter how many times I've done it.
Amazing. Let us talk a little bit about skepticism. We have a picture here of you with James Randi, and it says, this is a quote from you, actually, I think, Penn, "Without Randi, there would be no Penn and Teller bullshit, and no Penn and Teller that you would recognize." Do you want to speak to that? What's the influence of Randi?
Well, I already answered that. I mean, I think without Randi and without Teller, I'm probably a morning DJ. I think I would have been happy.
I think you're an existential novelist.
Well, an existential novelist who's also doing Drive Time with Lucy in the Sky with Traffic. Let's go there now. Remember, it's Rocktober. But I was not headed down any sort of path toward magic without Randi. And the parts of magic that I'm fascinated by, and I think much more so than Randi, the parts of magic I'm fascinated by are the parts of magic that most other magicians fight against. Most other magicians want to have some element of fantasy in what they're doing, some element of wish fulfillment in what they're doing, some element of a different kind of make-believe than we do. And because of Randi and conversation with Teller, I was able to come into that not liking any of that. You know, I can't stand Lord of the Rings. You know, I disagree with Jeff McBride on most everything except his fashion. I don't think that idea that I wish I could fly, or, you know, I wish I was someone painting a picture who could actually get laid. You know, that usual kind of magician stuff, I've always found repulsive. And Randi presented the magician, and Houdini, of course, too, but Randi more so. Randi presented the magician as someone who deals with how people decide what reality is. It's always a decision, and it's always a shared decision, and we don't have any real sense of reality that comes into us. But that exploration of what we want to consider real and how those things work is all I care about in magic is stage magic.
Okay.
And many, many, many other magicians care about the stage magic and also think, oh, but the magic wand, hocus pocus stuff is so fascinating. I believe I have less interest in that than anyone I've ever met. And I don't think about wish fulfillment. I just don't care about any of that. And I think that I may have brought that to Randi, but Randi gave me a way to express that, which is more important than having the original thought.
Yeah, Randi gave us the idea that the subject of magic could be very interesting. That's something we've done again and again and again, where we sort of, yes, we do tricks, which we call tricks, in a very Randi-like way, and we take, but we take you backstage for little trips, all because, I mean, in many ways, Randi reminded us that every single person in our audience has had a magic set or read a magic book. And to come to the group with the same way that we would come to you audience here, with the knowledge that you know stuff, instead of that this is, you know, that David Blaney sort of thing where you go, oh, well, is it real or is it not? Nah, that's just creepy.
Okay. Well, sticking with skepticism, of course, you made Bullshit. It was hugely successful. One of the themes of this conference is bringing skepticism alive, which is what you've done incredibly well. In a moment, we'll go briefly for a few questions from the audience, if you can think of those. But time is pushing on. So, but I did want to play in this one clip, because I think it's just so good at showing the kind of way we can bring skepticism alive. So this is about vaccinations from Bullshit.
Hi, I'm Penn. This is my partner, Jack. You may have heard vaccination causes autism in 1 out of 110 children. Fuck that. Total bullshit. It doesn't. But let's imagine it does. We'll compare two groups of children. Teller's group gets no vaccinations. My group does. I'll use this plexiglass to represent the vaccinations. Oh, that's bad. My vaccination wall knocked one of the children out of line. That's our 1 in 110 with autism. In the 1920s, before the diphtheria vaccination was common, there were 13 to 15,000 deaths a year from that disease. If you've got it, your chances of dying were about 40%. In 1952, just before the Salk vaccine became common, there were about 58,000 cases of polio. If you get unlucky, you might end up permanently disabled or dead. Meningitis, hepatitis A and B, flu, mumps, whooping cough, pneumonia, rotavirus, rubella, smallpox, tetanus, chickenpox. We have vaccinations against all of them. Which side do you want your child to stay? So even if vaccination did cause autism, which it fucking doesn't, that vaccination would still be bullshit.
Thank you.
Thank you, but I also want to say, I need to say, Michael Godeau, who was one of the writers on Bullshit, and absolutely brilliant. His son has autism.
Okay.
And he robos that bit.
Amazing.
I mean, his son is neurodiverse. Yeah. I don't think I used the proper term.
Okay. Aside from the magic, if it was just the magic, it would be an astonishing career. Then it's Bullshit. Then it's Foolus. And then it's writing books. You've written three books there. In addition to that, you have your own projects, working on Macbeth and other books of magic and Tim's Veneer and stuff. My question is, have you thought of doing something on time management? Because how do you find the time to do, not only that, you're performing at the Rio pretty much every night. How do you find the time to do all of this?
My children make fun of me because I do everything with a stopwatch. I do a half an hour of studying Spanish. I do a half an hour of writing my two new novels. And I do like 45 minutes of working on meditating on new bits for Penn and Teller. I work on all this stuff, and it's all done by, it didn't used to be that way, but it's developed now that I do everything, almost everything by stopwatch.
In 45 minute blocks?
Yeah. Or 30, usually 30 minute blocks. And I'll tell you the trick that I like really the most, I love this trick. When I'm working on this new novel, and when I'm working on it, I set the timer for 30 minutes, and when it goes off, I lift my fingers up, even in the middle of a word. And what that allows you to do is get money for nothing and chicks for free, because you're not working, but your subconscious keeps working, and you come back the next day, and it's just without even thinking about it once. It's just, and I think it's really important not to finish a cadence. And Teller, when we rehearse, he has a hard out at 4:30. And so we walk away when we really, really, really want to finish. And I think that helps a lot. I think leaving stuff unfinished is the best way to get it finished.
Amazing. Teller, any thoughts on?
No, the one thing that we do more or less regularly is meet for coffee or meet for rehearsals in any given time. And you've got to have some kind of rhythm like that to make things happen. I am not as well organized as Penn. I lurch.
We have a few minutes for questions. One for opportunity to ask Penn and Teller pretty much anything about their astonishing body of work. So any hands up for any questions? I can see lots of hands going up. George.
Yeah, hi. Would you mind sharing the backstory as to why and how Copperfield got you fired?
Say it one more time.
The question, which we'll ignore, was, can you explain how David Copperfield got you fired?
Oh, it's very simple. I was being very very glib about that. Copperfield's a friend of ours, but when Copperfield came into the MGM, he's a much bigger star than we are, and he came in and said he didn't want any other magic shows there, and that was what he wanted, and that's what he got, and it turned out to be one of the great things that happened to us. But it was not done maliciously. I said it that way because I thought it might be a little funny.
Thank you. Some other questions. I can't see where George is at the moment. Oh, yeah, person here.
Penn, I'd like to take you to a different area, nutrition. You had a very impressive weight loss, right? How is that going now? What diet are you on now?
It's not going as well as it should. As you can see, I'm about, I would say 20 pounds up from where I should be. My friend Dr. Clapper would say 60. You know, every study says that the thinner you are, the better off you are in health. Karen Carpenter accepted. And I'm vegan. I started out being a vegan for health purposes, and now it's become ecological compassionate in terms of suffering. That's changed, maybe because I don't have the meat cooties in my stomach that put those hormones in, but I became vegan. But vegan is only covers the compassion and the ecological for the health reasons. It's just, you know, no processed food. And I try to eat one meal a day, which I am sloppier on than I used to be, which is why I'm heavier. And I just know that when my weight is down low, that I'm actually happier. It's very, very funny, but I never believed in a mind-body duality. I always thought that everything was physical. That was part of being an atheist and a skeptic. But it turns out I actually did believe that, because I actually thought that my happiness and my ability to think were separate from my body. And it turned out when I lost about 110 pounds, my happiness and my thinking abilities were tied completely to my weight. And also, there's a lot of studies that say that eating meat, the cooties that grow in your guts because of eating animal products, do send hormones that and signals to your brain that do change the way you feel and the way you think. And I used to think that was total bullshit. And as a matter of fact, there's a bullshit show where I say that. But as of course, I want to say right now, everything we did on bullshit, we were wrong about. Everything gets refined as you learn. But I just find that works really, really well. And all the people that join me in this and all the doctors that I know, I haven't seen anything to contradict it.
Okay. Thank you. Question.
I've loved you as an author. I loved your book on the weight. I loved the one on God, or lack of God. Last year when I was here, I picked up Random. Where the hell did you get the idea for that book, which I absolutely loved?
Oh, good. I was waiting for the boy. You should stick to essays. That's a long story. I did a book tour on that, and I don't want to take up this time when it's not really. But it was actually there's a book called The Dice Man that was written in the 70s. That's essentially a comedy, and then there was a person we worked with on a show that I found out was living dice life, and I found that very chilling. The idea of dice life, which is the concept of the book Random, is that we all make decisions, and the decisions we make are the thing we want to do the most. Now, that seems obvious, but it means that the second tier, the third tier, the fourth tier of things that are absolutely part of your heart are never acted upon. And the idea of dice life is the rolls of a dice are a bell curve, and when you're making a decision on something, the thing you want to do the most, you get give 6, 7, and 8. And the things that you sincerely want to do but aren't going to win, you put over it 2 and 12, and then you roll the dice and act instantly as though it were a god, which is very easy to tap into. Atheists all know that. You can tap into that part of us that wants to have a god instantly. You just do that instantly, and it without question, and it changes your life profoundly. It's just expressing parts of you that aren't the thing you want to do most. And the character, the character in the book, the lead character in that book, Bobby Ingersoll, may recognize the name, lives his life random. And the idea comes from a person I knew that was living random after the suicide of their brother, and also from the book, The Dice Man. And it's going to be Skydance is doing it as a, Skydance thinks they're doing it as a series. Of course, we all fail, so we don't know if they will. But they paid me money, so.
Excellent.
They think they're doing it.
I know you're super busy. Penn and Teller, obviously, the Rio. If you want to see one of the greatest magic shows in the world, this is your opportunity to do that. Before we let you go. yeah, because your other stuff is on YouTube and people can watch it there. So, before we let you go, future of Penn and Teller. What's in the works? What's coming up? Where are you going?
I don't know. I mean, we've always said we intended to die in office, and neither one of us has talked seriously about retirement, at least to each other. I don't know, maybe you've. We haven't talked. we haven't talked about that, and we don't intend to do that. But of course, as you get older, things change. You know, my child Moxie is doing magic, yeah. And the first episode of Fool Us, Moxie kicked it off, and Moxie had her show in Edinburgh.
I saw it.
And I guess there's a weird kind of pride in this. We did a thing called Magic Goes Wrong with the. A ridiculous theater company, which I called the Wrong Boys, that did Play That Goes Wrong, Peter Pan Goes Wrong, et cetera, et cetera. We wrote a show with them that has some of our tricks in it. There's a touring show out now, or just finished being out, called Foolers, where there's a bunch of magicians doing their own material, but also some of ours. And I saw that. I've seen Moxie do stuff that I wrote. And I can say with much, much pride that, tonight, I mean, there's a time difference, but it's already happened. But Jandro, who I consider to be one of the greatest magicians in the world, Spanish magician, just did one of our bits in his show and killed with it tonight. And I'm very proud of that. So it never crossed my mind till the past year that that people doing our material would be something that would happen. Mm.
Okay.
And it's kind of nutty. But I believe that, you know, Orson Welles said to create for legacy is more base than creating for money. And I believe that's really true. Once you think about your legacy, you've violated some major thing in your heart. But as far as our performing in Penn and Teller stuff, I can't see a reason to stop until we can no longer do it.
I would like to be found dead in a box on stage. I just want to say, one of the things that's fascinating about this Foolers tour is that to see other people working on and then doing the material that we've created makes me very excited and proud to know that there is a strength that wasn't just our performance, but there's actually a strength in the writing of that material. It kind of thrills me.
And every time they get a slightly less big laugh than I did with the same line, it also thrills me.
Well, thank you. And when I was preparing for this, I was looking over the unbelievable body of work that you two have produced. And within magic, it is just incredible. I mean, probably the greatest magic in the last 100 years. So thank you for that. You have been a friend to skepticism throughout all of your careers. And thank you for that. If Penn and Teller have had a positive effect on your life, this is the moment to let them know. Thank you very much for coming along. Please say a huge thank you to the legendary Penn and Teller.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, it's a very good job.
Penn and Teller, Richard Wiseman, ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for him.
Thanks very much.